and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Diane Geller and Heather Ries with Fox Rothschild, LLP. At Fox Rothschild, is a national law firm that delivers strategic and practical solutions for clients. They are innovative and entrepreneurial, a spirit that attracts some of the brightest legal talent from across the country. Home to 950 attorneys nationwide, Fox offers a team of accomplished professionals who deliver high-quality, industry-specific solutions to clients through the toughest challenges. They understand today's competitive business environment and take a value-driven, business-minded approach to the law. With more than 70 practice areas, they provide a broad range of legal services in order to meet their clients' needs. Diane provides strategic legal counsel services to a wide array of private and public companies. She has a particular focus on representing clients in the staffing industry. A former general counsel for a major public company in the staffing and funding industry, Diane is a seasoned practitioner who helps clients stay compliant with the ever-changing federal and state regulations governing the workplace, as well as the daily challenges facing business owners. Heather is a trusted business advisor and seasoned litigator who has a deep understanding of employment and staffing law, as well as an extensive experience assisting creditors in the bankruptcy courts. She has developed a robust practice with clients rely on for creative solutions, practical results, and zealous advocacy when disputes arise. Heather advises clients on a variety of business-related matters, including transactions and employment-related issues that arise as a matter of operations. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Diane and Heather will discuss how client financial distress can present significant challenges for staffing companies and can drastically affect the company's bottom line. They will share insights, insightful analysis of the issues for the staffing companies must address to minimize the risk from client financial distress and what to do if a client files bankruptcy. So today we'll cover how to minimize the impact of a client's financial issue or bankruptcy, what happens to your contract with the client debtor, who is responsible for the staffed employee's wages, whether an outstanding invoice for staffed employees is entitled to priority payment in bankruptcy, and what to do if you receive a demand from a bankruptcy trustee for the return of payments received by your staffing company. We will monitor the chat feature today, so if you have any questions or comments during the presentation, please chat with us via the chat feature. And with that, I will turn the floor over to Diane and Heather.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Diane Geller. Some of you may know me. I've been kicking around the staffing industry for quite a long time. And my partner, Heather Ries, is joining me today, as Amanda said. So we're going to give you kind of an overview of some of the issues that staffing companies need to be aware of, both to make sure that they're collecting their receivables and then what to do in the unfortunate situation that a client files bankruptcy, and how maybe you can anticipate the problem and get on top of it or ahead of it. That's our typical legal disclaimer, so let me move forward from there. So some of the things we're going to talk about today in terms of show me the money are client collections and best practices for minimizing risk, and client bankruptcy is in what you should do. So Heather,
What can I do to protect my business before a client files for bankruptcy?
Go ahead, Heather. I was asking you that question.
Oh, sorry.
Actually, maybe it's me. I'm sorry. We're a little confused.
That's okay. There's certain warning signs that you were going to talk about.
Yes, you're right. So some of those warning signs that you should be aware of are payment reliable customers when they start stretching out payments. So that customer that always paid in 15 or 30 days all of a sudden becomes a 45 or 60 day pay. And then it starts to slide toward 90 or 120 days. You know, right now you are then on notice that you've got a potential problem there. You also may see it if the client starts paying less than the full invoice, and that which makes them fall further and further behind. Excuses. Client gives excuses to your collection people for their failure to pay or why they're late paying. My business is fine. It's our own customers that aren't paying. Well, if their own customers aren't paying, then possibly they don't have the money to pay you, which should be a red flag to you. They may tell you that their circumstances are temporary and that they'll get caught up soon, or even worse, they stop returning your calls or emails. You might start hearing rumors that your client is having some cash flow problems, or that they're in financial difficulty. So you really need to react when you start hearing these issues. Another big red flag is when key employees are starting to leave. So you hear key management leaving and going elsewhere. That's usually a sign that there's something wrong, or if they're falling behind on other debt. Okay, Heather, now you can take the forefront.
So it's a new year. How can you collect those delinquent accounts receivable? Usually at the end of the year, about the first week of December, we start getting calls from our clients who are starting to look at their AR, because that end of the year is approaching quickly, and saying, what do I do to collect this delinquent accounts receivable? Well, you need to problem solve when clients appear to have hit a financial roadblock. By example, I know you all have contracts. I know that these clients have agreed to pay a certain amount for your services, and you are certainly entitled to collect that amount. But sometimes it's better to compromise the amount of the debt, except 90%, 80%, because it's better to collect some money rather than no money, or to enter into a payment plan, or maybe you're continuing to provide them services and they can overpay a little bit every month to try to catch up. You want to listen and be assertive as opposed to aggressive, because you don't want people to start ghosting you and not responding to your emails and your phone calls. Trying to work something out is always the best and cheapest solution. You're running a business, keep it professional, not emotional. Emails, memos to clients, guilting them and talking about personal relationships are not the way to go. And finally, know when it's time for a demand letter. Sometimes a demand letter from an attorney is all you need. 4 out of 5 times people will respond to that, and you won't have to sue them. You'll get paid, and sending a demand letter is an inexpensive solution.
Yeah, realize too, though, that with working with Tricom, I'm sure that they will provide you with some assistance, and you certainly need to coordinate with them if you're going to settle a debt. Okay, so we want to go through 10 ways to manage payment risk. So the first way is obviously to maintain good records. As potentially the creditor in any kind of situation, you've got the burden to establish that your claim against the debtor. Just like you need to establish that it's a good debt to Tricom, you're going to need to do the same thing in any type of unfortunate court arrangement. You also have to be able to set yourself up for defenses to what's called a preferential transfer claim brought by the debtor or its trustee, and Heather will cover that a little bit later in our program. It's essential that those records be clear and complete and concise and show the transactional history with the debtor. That might include contracts, if you've got signed contracts, your invoices, anything that states the payment terms, the services provided, the date the payment was received, the method that they paid, any late fees or penalties applied, and communications with the debtor regarding the payments. Again, you need to work with Tricom to put, you may need to work with Tricom to put all that together. But a well-documented account history gives you an advantage if the bankruptcy trustee is going to come in and try and claim a preference, because relying on shoddy records are just not going to cut it. Best practice would be to establish and have a standardized protocol for maintaining those records. The next thing would be the open lines of communication. Clearly, you should agree that you're going to alert each other if there's anything that could impact the working relationship. And once again, this is how you have a good working relationship with your customer. That way, you'll also know if the accounts payable person happens to mention that the CFO is leaving, or that the company is in merger talks, or that may be a sign of financial trouble. Other signs could include when a payment reliable customer starts, as we talked about, stretching payments, making excuses, having cash flow problems, all of those issues that we talked about before become keys to knowing something is wrong. Setting a credit limit, that's extremely important, because if you're going to extend credit to customers, you need to be sure to set a limit. Tricom may help you do that, but allowing a customer to exceed their credit limit increases your risk. So if you're going to set a credit limit, you have to stick to it. Don't keep broadening it without really making an affirmative decision that that's what you intend to do. So who's ever watching your AR needs to alert management if there's an issue or if they're starting to push that credit. Exceeding those credit limits is also oftentimes that they could be struggling financially. They could be going through a growth spurt, but you need to be able to make an affirmative decision about whether that credit limit should be extended further. Taking action to collect excessive outstanding balances could impair your ability to assert valid defenses in a preference transfer claim. And once again, we'll talk about that, because preference transfers have very clear definitions. Depositing checks promptly, obviously your deposits go to Tricom. The interesting thing is that most payments are applied to the oldest invoices first. Certainly, if it's an invoice identified, I'm guessing Tricom is going to apply it to that. But you need to understand this, that if there's someone going into a financial difficult situation, you may want to have Tricom and talk to Tricom about depositing those checks and applying them to the most recent invoices. That will help if there's a preference claim later. And then lastly, you want to avoid that single source dependence. And that's a very big issue for many staffing companies, because they get that really great client and they're spending most of their resources supporting that client. Well, when that client reaches you 40% of your business, you're really impairing your business. You need to avoid that dependence on a particular client, both because if they're going into a bad financial situation, then that's going to also impair you. But it also, if you're planning to sell your business at any time in the future, you want to have a much broader base of clientele. Heather?
You want to implement standard payment terms and be consistent. You know, if you have 30 days, 45 days, 60 day terms, you want to make sure you're staying consistent because that allows you to identify very easily when people are getting behind. And to follow up with them. So hopefully you have some kind of tickler system, perhaps, that you're relying on or calendaring to know when people have not been making payments. Quick termination contract provisions. The reason that this can be important is if you sense that a client is having financial issues or they've gotten far behind, you have a choice. Are you going to cut and run end the relationship, or are you going to continue on and hopefully collect the AR during your continued relationship? Once a bankruptcy is filed, you are stuck. I know that everybody puts in those provisions that say, if you file a bankruptcy, it's a default. If you file a receivership, it's a default. But those are called ipso facto clauses and are not enforceable in bankruptcy. So once the client files a bankruptcy, you're stuck with your contract until the debtor either rejects the contract, assumes the contract, or assumes and assigns it to someone else. So when you see a bankruptcy filing coming and you may not want to be involved in it, you want to cut and run, as I said, you would want to have a shorter termination provision where you could terminate immediately or on very short notice if need be. Letters of credit, guarantees, and other security. When people start, well, you could do this on the front end. If you've done a credit check and you've decided that the client is not as credit worthy as you would like them to be, you could always ask for some additional security up front. Either in the form of a security deposit or some kind of personal guarantee from the business owner. They may not give it, but it can't hurt to ask if you have concerns. Receivable insurance. This is a product that's available out in the marketplace. You probably don't want to buy it for all of your AR, but if you do have one particular client, perhaps with a large AR balance, you're a little bit concerned about whether you're going to get paid, you may want to investigate AR insurance. There's several companies that have it. And what happens is you pay a premium rate, and it's usually for a set period of time. And if the person files a bankruptcy, then you, for instance, get paid 90% of the receivable or 80% of the receivable, depending on what you negotiate. The insurer takes over the claim, you have the money in your pocket, and then they have to go and try to collect the money from the bankruptcy estate. And we talked a little bit about the last one, which was just require payments in advance. If you have maybe a direct hire relationship, you know, a retained relationship, you could get maybe a deposit up front or a first payment up front rather than waiting until you've already placed the candidate. Next slide.
Thank you. Okay, so who pays your bill? And the reason why that's important is it determines whether or not you have to file a claim if a bankruptcy is filed and whether the debtor or the trustee can have a preference. So that's always important. The payment made to you has to be the property of the debtor to be avoided as a preference. Sometimes your client bill is paid by an affiliated entity or principal, such as a bank obligated on a letter of credit or a factoring company on the other end. For staffing businesses, you also need to be aware of the VMSs that you're contracting with, because obviously the VMS will bill and collect from the client, and they keep their service fees and then usually pass the balance on to you. But that means that all of that money is coming in and being deposited into their account before you ever see it. And where that becomes an issue is when you're dealing with, if some of you that have been around the industry for a long time may remember the Ensemble Chimes global bankruptcy. It's a long time ago now, but it was back in 2008, and the trustee ended up filing 750 lawsuits. Chimes was using many staffing companies, and those staffing companies really, many of them ended up filing bankruptcy or having to go into protection as a result of it. Actually, what ended up happening was because Chimes got into financial difficulty, initially with the IRS, where they had to pay $31 million to the IRS in 2007, and then their lender swept another $22.5 million out of their accounts in 2008, and that effectively sunk the company. The problem is that there were lots of preference payment claims. Part of what caused Chimes to go under was the fact that the corporate checking account was being used a little bit like a personal piggy bank, with people, the management there, buying lots of personal luxury items out of business money. So as I said, 750 lawsuits were filed. Many staffing companies resulted in having a bad problem. We'd love to see VMS escrowing the monies that they receive. In most cases, they don't do that. So really keeping an eye on your VMS is so important, and trying to take some kind of affirmative step if you're not getting paid fast enough. Heather?
You want to be careful when you're applying payment pressure. We talked a little bit about having a certain repayment period for your invoices, watching when people fall behind, following up with them. You should have a collection plan that you're following in the ordinary course of your business. The reason for that is that if the client were to end up in a bankruptcy case and you received a large payment from them within the 90 days that they filed, you could be subject to a clawback action for what's called a preferential transfer. And there are certain defenses to a preferential transfer. One of them is ordinary course. But if you have used extraordinary collection activities, strong threatening of the client for payment that does not fall within your collection plan, that defense may not be available to you. Also, if you allow the receivable to get too far behind, let's say they owe you $500,000 and they pay you that $500,000 within the 90 days before the bankruptcy, when they were supposed to be paying, you know, a certain amount every 30 days, that also starts to fall outside of the ordinary course. Other ways to manage your risk. We've talked about some of these already. And so I think we can actually skip this slide. What should I do if my client files for bankruptcy? Well, there's a couple of things. A bankruptcy is meant to give the debtor a breathing spell and a fresh start. There's something called the automatic stay, which accomplishes that for the debtor. So you must cease all collection efforts. That means do not call the debtor and ask for money they owe you. Do not send them letters. Do not send them emails, because that's considered a violation of the automatic bankruptcy stay and could subject you to sanctions by the bankruptcy court. You want to make sure you retain your records. You're going to need that to file your proof of claim, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, which you have to properly document. But you may also need it if you end up getting a demand letter for one of those clawback actions we've been referencing. You want to identify what kind of bankruptcy it is. Is it a Chapter 7 where it's, everything's going to be liquidated? Or is it a Chapter 11 where there's a hope that the debtor is going to reorganize its business and move forward? You want to confirm your deadlines because there are a couple that are like the statute of limitations that come up quickly, and if you miss them, you're done. One is the proof of claim deadline, the deadline to file one of those proofs of claim for the money that you're owed, and then there are some other deadlines. You want to determine the status of your relationship. What is the status of your contract? What are its terms, et cetera. So what's next? Next slide. File a proof of claim, creditors committees, critical vendors, administrative claims, and effects on your contract. Next slide. So proofs of claim, what is it? It's a proof of claim form that you're going to fill out to indicate the amount that you are owed by the debtor through the date of the bankruptcy filing. It's very easy to do. It's a form. You fill it out. You attach all of those records that you have kept because you have good record keeping, and you file it by the deadline. So sometimes people think it's not worth it. They're like, oh, the person's bankrupt. I'm never going to get any money out of this. It's worth it. It only takes a short period of your time to put it together. And sometimes there are 100% cases, and sometimes there are 10% cases, meaning that you get 10% of what you're owed at some point. Some money is better than no money, and like I said, it takes very little time for you to go ahead and do it. Next slide. Is my outstanding invoice for staffing companies entitled to priority, Diane?
Thanks, Heather. So probably not, and it's a question that Heather and I get asked pretty regularly. I know when I was in-house counsel, we tried very hard to get the invoices for our staffed employees treated as a priority payment. And once, maybe twice, and all the times we did it, we were able to get it treated priority. But for the most part, employee wage claims enjoy priority status, staffing firms claims don't, because it includes both the what you've paid your individual temp plus, or your consultant, plus the taxes plus your markup. So unfortunately, it's generally not considered in priority status, and they treat it like unpaid vendor invoices, which are general unsecured claims and not a priority claim. Heather, you want to talk about the creditors committee?
Sorry, I muted myself. Sure. So creditors committees, they only exist in Chapter 11 cases, which are usually reorganizations or sales of assets in a more structured way, usually to a new business owner. U.S. Trustee's Office appoints creditors committees. The way that it works is if you're a creditor in their bankruptcy case, usually one of the top 20 creditors, you'll get a letter in the mail soliciting you to serve on the creditors committee. And at that point, you need to make a decision whether you want to actually serve or not. There are some benefits to serving on the committee. You get to be involved in investigating the debtor's financial condition and see if all that information. You get to participate in the negotiation and formation of their plan, which is either a reorganization or a sale. And you do what's best for all the creditors. You don't need to have your own attorney because the creditors committee has an attorney that represents the creditors committee as a whole, so you benefit in that way as well. Should you participate? It depends. Do you have the time? It does take some time. There are meetings that you have to attend. And Are you interested in looking at all of the information and having discussions about a plan, a creditors committee, et cetera? So it just depends. Is my staffing business a critical vendor? This is very important because we were talking about the priority issue before with Diane. If you are providing staffing services to a company that goes into bankruptcy and you provide a majority of their staff, like for instance, a manufacturing facility or a healthcare business, the answer may be yes. Because they rely on you to operate their business, and without your staff, they wouldn't be able to do so. So you may want to, when the bankruptcy is filed, approach the debtor about considering you for critical vendor status. What does that do for you? Well, it gets you paid usually all of the pre-petition amount that you're owed by the debtor. And then you continue to do business with the debtor post-petition, which they have to pay you under the code. It's one of the duties of the debtor. And if they don't, your claim is an administrative claim, which gets paid before everybody else except secured creditors. And finally, you may be able to negotiate waiver of any kind of preference claim. Do I have an administrative claim? That's a little bit of what we talked about. Diane, you want to talk about that?
Right. If you've provided services during a Chapter 11, the good news is that your services are required to be paid in the ordinary course of the business. So that's really a very positive thing if you continue to support them. If they then fall behind or fail to pay, then it's treated as an administrative claim and it's entitled to the highest priority beside the secured claims, which is puts you in a much better position with respect to that money. And, you know, but it also has to requires you to properly monitor post petition payments for the need to file an administrative claim. So like everything else, you have to stay aware of what's happening. What happens to your contract with the client debtor? Part of this is also, as Heather spoke before, about trying to redo your client contract to make sure that you can terminate it on very short notice so that you can try and get out from under it before they file bankruptcy. Because if the contract is still in place, once they file bankruptcy, you lose the ability to terminate the contract. And is what's called a executory contract under which one or both of the parties still have duties to perform. In terms of assignment and assumption, the debtor could seek to assume your contract and even possibly assign it to a third party, such as a buyer of its assets, since your contract is considered an asset. The benefit of an assignment is that all the past due debt has to be paid, and it must be cured as part of that assignment. So the next question becomes, what should I do if my staffing business receives a demand from the debtor client or bankruptcy trustee for return of the monies I received? And this is what we've been talking about. This is what happens in a preference payment. Before we go to why me, the things you should know is don't ignore it. Pay attention to it. It's much easier to negotiate and resolve a preference demand than prior to a complaint being filed. And that's what happens is actually a litigation is filed. You can try and respond without an attorney, but unless you really understand preference and fraudulent transfer laws, you're better off utilizing an attorney who is familiar with that type of practice. And definitely, if you receive a complaint, you should immediately talk to a business litigation attorney to help you evaluate it and protect your interests. Because I've had many clients that have had to write a check returning money to the debtor because it happened within that preference period. So they don't, the other important thing is that in this type of a complaint, they don't require personal service by a process server. So they can serve you by US mail and there's a limited time to respond. So if you do get this wonderful greeting in the mail, you need to take it seriously. It's also the date to respond runs from the date of the issuance of the summons and not when you receive it. Another really important issue. So be careful of that dating. I guess one more thing in terms of why me. So the preference transfer looks at a creditor that's received payment that results from that creditor getting a better situation or better treatment than the other creditors. And we've heard in many other circumstances the word equity, and that's really what this is. This is an attempt to give equity to the other similarly situated creditors by recovering money from those that had a preference and redistributing the money more equally. So it may not feel equitable to you, and it may not result in equity in your favor, but that's basically the concept behind it and what's being done. So Heather, maybe you can go through what a preference transfer is.
Sure, a preferential transfer, the trustee or the debtor has to prove certain elements. The first one is a transfer to or for the benefit of a creditor by the debtor. If you recall, Diane was talking about knowing who your client is and who pays your bill. This is where that becomes important, because if your bill is paid by someone besides the entity that filed for bankruptcy, then you can't generally have a preference. Transfer must relate to an antecedent debt. Antecedent debt is money you're owed for services you've already provided. So we talked a little bit about prepayment. If you've been prepaid by the debtor for your services, it wouldn't be a preference because it's not a payment for an antecedent debt. The transfer must have been made while the debtor was insolvent. Usually that's they just look at the assets and the liabilities and determine that based on book entry. So the transfer had to occur within the 90 days prior to the bankruptcy filing. That's why depositing the check as quickly as you receive it is a good practice, because the quicker you deposit the check, the time starts to tick on those 90 days as opposed to holding it. And the transfer must be provided, transfer must have provided a benefit to the creditor in excess of what the creditor would have received. So in that particular case, for instance, if you had a security deposit or you got paid up front, it wouldn't be a preference because you didn't receive more than you would have received when the debtor files for bankruptcy, because you have a security that you're holding, not being paid for an antecedent debt. Defenses. Security is what we talked about. Do you have a security deposit? Are you being prepaid? Is this a retained search? So you're getting some of your money up front. New value, that is when you have been paid and then you continue to provide services to the debtor and have not been paid for them. So for instance, if you got paid within 90 days of the bankruptcy for $10,000 and you end up getting a demand letter from the trustee and you've provided $15,000 more of services since the payment, that would cancel out the potential preference that the trustee or the debtor would have. Ordinary course of business, that one is more difficult to prove. You usually need an expert, but it's basically what we talked about. they're staying within invoice terms within a couple of days when they're making their payments. Unfortunately, debtors are not usually paying in the ordinary course. And finally, contemporaneous exchange.
Records are so important. Yeah, that's another reason why records are so important.
Right, and contemporaneous exchange probably is not as valid for staffing companies. That would be kind of like a COD payment. I think it's unlikely that you're providing staffing services in exchange for immediate payment. How can you reduce your preference liability? We've talked about a lot of these already, creating a security interest or lien, requiring prepayment, COC, maintaining good records, implementing standard payment terms. Let's see, are there any that we haven't talked about already? Nope, we've covered them all.
Okay, so I don't know whether there's any questions. I don't see any in the chat, but if you do have questions later, you know, if you have any now, obviously, Amanda, I guess we are happy to take them. And if not, on the next slide, oh no, on this slide, you'll see here's our email addresses and phone numbers. Here, feel free to email us your questions and we'll respond to them.
Wonderful. Can you help explain why applying invoice payments as they come in to current invoices helps in bankruptcy as opposed to applying them to the oldest or to the invoices that are referenced on the remittances?
Sure. I'll give you a kind of a real life example. Let's say somebody is 180 days behind on payment. And they finally make a payment and you're applying it towards the oldest invoice as opposed to an invoice that's within invoice terms. Let's say you've invoiced them in the last 30 days. Your invoice terms are 30 days. You receive a payment. If you apply that payment to the newest invoice, they are within the ordinary course of their business. They're paying within invoice terms for that particular invoice. If you apply the payment to the oldest invoice, which we talked about being 180 days old, now you're outside of the ordinary course. They're paying a very old invoice, and that hurts your ordinary course defense if you were to get a demand letter for preference.
Sure, that makes sense, especially in maybe like a structured payment plan where there's fixed payment amounts. I could see how that could definitely make a difference. Would having the customer reference a specific maybe 180-day invoice, if that's what they referenced on the invoice, on the remit, I should say, and if you applied it to something different, would that cause a problem with, I guess, that defense?
I don't do the regulation part of that, but it's my understanding that if the client specifically indicates on the memo or in another communication, the invoice that the payment should be applied to, then you have to apply it to that particular invoice. So you wouldn't have as much flexibility.
Okay, that makes perfect sense. Thanks for clarifying that.
Yeah, I think it's more an on-account payment. So if you're making just an on-account payment, then and you know, or you have a reason to believe that they're having financial difficulty, then you know that's where you want to apply it to the most recent, and then work your way backwards.
Okay. Well, great. Well, thank you so much for you know, kind of clarifying that distinction, because I do think it's an important distinction. You know, for any of us that have had to deal. You know, with debtors that, you know, are slow pay, you know, those are the types of questions that do arise. So I appreciate you guys taking the time out of your schedule to go through, you know, and discuss this in such great detail. I'd like to thank all of our attendees for joining us today, and you know, for both Heather and Diane for sharing information on your best practices for minimizing the financial risk to your staffing business. We will post a recording of the webinar on our website, and watch for additional information on future sessions. But thank you all. I hope you have a great day.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.